guys and gals that have given their lives to Jesus, and they want to make that profession of faith public before you and before other witnesses and their family members. So we're going to get started here. Daniel? This is Daniel DeArmas, and he's a precious young man. And he's a birthday boy, too, yesterday. Daniel, because of your profession of faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank everybody that's here supporting me and supporting all of us. I want to thank my family because they've helped me through times that I wasn't able to help myself. I just want to say thank you to y'all and I love y'all.
Victor, because of your profession of faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Memphis Thomas, and he's been a part of this church since he was a little bit, I think, since he was born. And anyway, as you can tell, he's overcome that. He's a precious young man. He loves Jesus with all his heart. He's a worship machine, and we're excited about his growth in Christ. Memphis, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Peyton, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the She loves Jesus with all her heart. And she's part of the family. A couple of guys went before her. Ready? Remember, because you're a professional faith, that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is Heavenly. She's Kiki's sister, and they both love Jesus with all their hearts. Heavenly, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God is good. That's our baptismal class of October 2019. You guys pass out. Josh, you go ahead and let the slides back down. All right, who's ready to praise God? All right. Well, go ahead and stand up. Miss Shonda, where's Miss Shonda? There's her beautiful daughter. All the kiddos that want to go to kids' church, go see Miss Michaela. All right, let's hear it for our kids. Hallelujah. Bye, guys. Everybody go with Miss Michaela in the back here. Hallelujah. While these guys are going out, I got one, or actually two quick announcements. One is, anybody got 12 minutes and 47 seconds for a child? 12 minutes, 47 seconds? Just me? Okay, that was it. Sister Doug, okay. After church, immediately after church, Miss Stacy is going to keep you for about 12 minutes to talk about the Hallelujah Carnival. I'm going to say on it, if you won't be there, come be part of it. We're going to give the kids an alternative for that night, a chance to witness a lot of good things. So please come see us immediately after service in the fellowship hall for 12 minutes and 47 seconds. If it goes over that, see Miss Stacy. I'm not the complaint department. So that was a joke. So anybody want to step out? The folks that wanted to come back up? How awesome is this? Look at these newborn children right now. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now comes the fun part. I've heard it said it takes a village. I think it takes a church. We're all responsible for these young people to live the right way in front of them, to be good examples. And here's a good example to show them how to worship God when you've been forgiven. Here's an example to show them how to worship God when you've been forgiven. Amen. We're working on it. Amen. Lydia gave you an amen. Guys, I can't tell you how important this part is. This is what softens the heart and gets the mind ready for the word that Pastor's about to give. Hallelujah. Thank you, God, for this time.
Bless you.
Thank you for the time that the musicians have spent preparing and be ready to lead us into your presence. And God, we are looking for something new today, Father God. Hallelujah. We're looking for a new experience. Father God, we're looking for you to knock down doors inside our heart, Lord God, and let your love and light invade those places we've kept secret and quiet. Father God, those that are here for that experience, I pray that they are overwhelmed by your love, your mercy, Father God. Hallelujah. Thank you, God, for being here. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness. All my life you have been faithful.
Come on, lift your voice this morning.
All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will say of the goodness of God.
I've known you as a friend, and I have lived.
To hide. It was I
God, we rejoice this morning. We lift our hands toward heaven. Come on, saints, stretch with me this morning. God, we lift our hands toward heaven, thanking you. God, you redeemed us when we were hopeless and helpless. You stepped into our horrible nightmare. You said, no, no death, no devil, no defeat. I redeemed you. I've called you by name. You're mine. And Lord, in that moment, you adopted us. You changed our entire history. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for changing everything about us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for seeing something in us we would never have seen ourselves. Thank you for giving heaven's very best for us. When we were helpless, when we were totally helpless and bankrupt, Christ died for the ungodly. Amen. All I have today, all I will ever experience in my life, all we will ever know or experience, is because of Jesus and his unlimited grace and kindness. Come on, say right there where you are. Just tell him your own way. Just thank him for what he's done for you right there. Would you just lift your mouth, open your mouth, and lift your heart in praise. Give him glory today. He's worthy of all glory and honor and praise. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We exalt you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that your name is higher than any other name. Thank you, Jesus. Ephesians says that you're seated above all principalities, all powers, God, every realm of authority. Jesus, you are above that. That's why we exalt you today, Lord, because you are the final authority. You love us. You value us. You call us your own. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Would you reach over and tap that hand right beside you if you can? Anybody connected? We don't want anybody disconnected today. There you go. God, we are so grateful to be here today. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to see the evidence of your work in hearts. It's glorious to see a child come to Christ, or a teenager, or an adult. Father, thank you for faith that you've generated in the hearts of so many today that have acknowledged your work by baptism. God, we pray for them today. We pray in the name of Jesus, every step of their journey. God, they'll be met with your extravagant grace. God, that you'll strengthen them and build them up in their most holy faith every day of their Christian experience. In Jesus' name. Thank you. Thank you. Father, we love you with all our hearts, our souls, our minds, our strength. We love you with everything in us. God, we pray for our brothers and sisters that are not with us this morning. We ask in the name of Jesus, wherever they may be, God, let your covering presence guard them and keep them, Father, in the name of Jesus. God, may all we do today in this service, as well as across the way of Cross Kids, we ask, Father, that everything we do exalts Jesus, gives him and him alone the praise and the honor. Jesus, thank you for praying for you. Everybody said amen? Amen. Come on, give Jesus a hand clap of praise this morning. Watch your hands, come on. Come on, you do better than that. Come on, give us a warm today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I was just informed by a close associate that there hadn't been very much hugging around here, so I know you just got seated, but go stand back up and go find some folks to love on. You come to Crossroads and don't get hugged, something's wrong. Amen. Thank you.
may have missed your bus. There's a second bus leaving. No, we're good to go. Hallelujah. If I could get the ushers to come up front. So last week somebody asked me, said, you guys have talked about the posture of giving, the position, and the purpose of giving. And so this week we decided we were, you guys looking for my hair? Find it? Anybody finds it, let me know. We're talking about the people of giving. And I found this one is very interesting. Anybody know the first person to give a tenth? Dan, you can't participate. Anybody?
Abraham.
Who said that? You get a free pass to heaven. He's already saved, we know that. He did. These four kings came and they just routed the countryside. And Abram was like, not happening in my neighborhood. So I think he took 318 men with him. And they went, 318 men and Abraham, and they routed four armies. They took their family back. They took their goods back. They took their land back. Anybody want to take your family back from Satan?
Yeah.
Anybody want to take away the money he stole from you? The things he cares of? The things that go on? If, who wants to take your position back, your home, your place? Who wants to take that back? Because who knows, we're living in the enemy territory. This is Satan's world, okay? This is what he did. When he came back, he never met this man, to my understanding, Melchizedek. It's a type of our God, his type of Christ. He comes back, and God moves on him, and his spirit says, here, I'm giving you a tenth of everything that we took from the enemy. And God blesses that. Now, it wasn't a tithe because it wasn't demanded. And the reason I start here is this, not because it was the first, but because I like this one the most. He didn't have to give, but he did. He didn't have to give, but he did. It reminds me of my grandbaby over here. She ain't gotta love me, but she does. She just does. And I can scare her, and I can be really silly with her, and she still goes, pop. She just loves me. That's what God wants from us. It isn't you have to. It ain't you got to. It's I get to. I said that again. I get to give back to God. Because trust me, every morning he wakes up and says, I get to bless him today. I get to bless him. I get to protect him. I get to put a hedge of angels around him. So as you give today, I want you to think about everything we've talked about. The next few weeks we're going to talk about the people and how they gave. Okay? Father God, thank you for this offering. Father God, we hold our offering up to you, Lord God. Bless this.
Yes.
Bless this offering, Father God, that it will promote your word, your love. It will go out into this community and pick people up on vans. It will run water into baptistry. It will supply Sunday school material. Father God, it will do the things that it's been called to do. But Father God, we pray for more. We pray that you would bless it. It press it down. It'd be running over and out, Lord God. I pray that it would be to the point where in the Bible they said, stop bringing the offering. We can't hold it anymore. God, bring us to that point with our hearts, Lord God, that we can honor you in everything that we do. And the church says,
there is nothing in my life.
Aren't you thankful for a Savior that makes our mistakes into something miraculous? Come on, give Him praise. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I had a phenomenal sermon prepared. The slides are on the Facebook page, and so you can preach it to yourself if you'd like later. If you have your Bibles with me, turn with me, please, to Galatians chapter 2. And stand to your feet, the reading of God's Word, Galatians 2:20. I'm actually going to be using the Passion Translation. You'll see it on the screen right behind me here, and we'll get to read it together. If you can see it, say amen.
Amen.
Okay, ready? Let's try it one more time in stereo. Ready? My old identity has been co-crucified with Messiah and no longer lives. For the nails of His cross crucified me with Him. And now the essence of this new life is no longer mine. For the Anointed One lives His life through me. We live in union as one. My new life is empowered by the faith of the Son of God, who loves me so much that He gave Himself for me and dispenses His life into mine. Father, we could not ever end praising You for what You have done for us. It's one thing to stop the curse. It's one thing to cut the sin nature and all this force and energy. It's one thing to end that. But You didn't stop there. When the sin nature was nailed to the cross, at that moment, resurrection life became our identity. The same life, the same power that got Jesus up out of the grave, that same power is in the believer.
Amen.
And Lord, every day You are dispensing Your life into mine. God, help us to understand that we're not just Christians, that we're not Assembly of God or Baptist or Foursquare or Lutheran or Episcopal or anything else. We are in Christ Jesus, and Christ Jesus is in us. It's the greatest revelation in creation because of what You've done, Lord. I owe nothing to my past. From that moment until now, my life is about experimenting and realizing and becoming more acquainted with what You have actually given me. God, there's so many believers today that live so far beneath their privileges.
They live as orphans, not sons. God, if there's anyone in this room today that has a religious spirit, that identifies with a faith, with a mechanism of faith, or with a doctrine of faith, but has not experienced the life of Christ, God, today, let the scales fall from their eyes and let them realize that Jesus is more important than anything else in the world.
Hallelujah.
And his life is real life. His life is the life worth living. Holy Spirit, I thank you, Lord. I thank you that your word is powerful and is quickened and it's alive today. God, do something significant inside our hearts today. And for all that's accomplished, we give you and you alone the praise, the honor, and the glory in Jesus' name. And all God's children said,
amen.
Amen. Look your neighbor on the way down and tell them, you look lots better this week than you did last week. You know, one of the, how do I start this? I have no notes. I just got a couple of scriptures. So when I first came to Christ, really, I had no clue. I had no clue because I was raised in religion, in a religious bondage. And so everything that I did up until the time I was 27 and a half years old was measured according to what a standard that some man set. That religion demanded and expected. And that's the reason why, there's a reason why people experiment with drugs, and there's a reason why people drink, and there's a reason why people do whatever they do, because they're trying to fill a void that is in their soul. And let me tell you something, religion is false advertising. You know, the other day I saw somebody at McDonald's do something that really hurt my heart. They asked for decaf coffee. And I happened to know this person, and so I stepped up and I said, that's false religion, just so you know. How could you advertise coffee and it be neutralized? Take the good stuff out anyway. But isn't that what happens with churchianity?
Oh,
yes, it is. We wear a cross or a Christian t-shirt, maybe go to a Christian concert periodically. But in terms of the actual Christ, life of Christ abiding in us and dwelling in us and being obvious in us, sometimes you have to look really, really hard to see if somebody's a Christian or not. Because their language don't give them away. Their choice of entertainment certainly doesn't look any different than the world's. And so at some point, see, my problem is this. I believe the Bible. I believe every single cotton-picking bit of the Bible. I believe the commas, the periods, the exclamation marks. I believe every single thing about the Bible is inspired of God. And when I read verses like that we just read a few moments ago, something happens inside of me. I want to scream. I want to run up against the wall or do something. Not to damage my brain. I've already had enough of that. But anyway, what I see in churchianity does not measure up to this word.
Come on.
Can we just be honest today as brothers and sisters in Christ? Thank you. See, if the Bible is correct, then you and I need to step up our game. Because if the Bible is correct, what it says is this. It says God is making something available to us.
Yes.
He said this. He said, I'm giving you everything I've got.
Amen.
Brother Ron, let me give you an example. I met a man years ago in Texas. You know, everything's bigger in Texas. And Chase said amen. Everything's bigger in Texas. And there's some big honking churches out there. I'm talking about some big churches. And so this guy, I got to meet him, and we paddled around a little bit. It was in the Frisco, Plano area. And so one thing led to another and all this. And somebody asked him in the group I was with, they said, well, how'd you build it? It was a beautiful, glorious building and everything. And somebody said, how'd you do this? And he looked at him like he was an alien. He said, well, I did it by faith. But how much money did you have in the bank when you started? What does that got to do with anything? He said, this is what he said that messed me up. I've been messed up ever since. He said, I didn't write. I didn't plan on my bank account. I planned by his. He said, the Holy Spirit told me that it's not your resources. He's your supplier, so dream big and plan big. You know what happened? In that little tiny area, a church began, and there was the first Sunday, there was 116 people there. By the 6 month mark, there were 500 people there. By the 5 year mark, there were 5,000 people there. And they kept building and expanding and expanding and building. And we were just shaking our heads and we were just like, you know, because if you count nickels and noses, I mean, you know, it's just gotta line up. Come on, talk to me something. It's just gotta line up. You know, it's gotta be doable. Uh-huh. And then he said this. One of the pastors I was with was small talk, you know, stuff was going on, and he said this. He said, well, he said, let me ask you a question, because we were all asking him. He said, let me ask you a question. Did God hedge his bet when it concerns you? Or did he give you extravagant grace whether you accepted it or not?
Come on, man.
He said, no, God loaded up. Somebody shout, he loaded up. He loaded up and he says, it's all yours, whether you use it or not. And if grace is limitless, then God's money is limitless.
Amen.
If he built this, if this is a speck in the universe, and a tiny speck at that, if this is a small, almost insignificant piece of the Milky Way galaxy, what in the, and if there are worlds to come, why would you think small?
Amen.
We all did what the Pharisees did when Jesus talked. We shut up. Well, isn't it the same thing with the life of Christ? If he says, I've given you power
yes.
over your adversary.
Amen.
People say, I'm afraid of the devil. Are you kidding me?
Come on.
Are you serious? Why would you be afraid of the devil? Because the Bible says that he's under Jesus' feet.
Yes.
And it says in Romans chapter 16, he will reproach him under our feet shortly.
Yes.
So the devil's not an entity that you need to be concerned about. Because resurrection life is inside you if this scripture is true. Put that back up one more time if you would please. Thank you, Josh. I'm going to dissect this with you. Is that okay? Good. My old identity, me and George are going to have a good time today. My old identity has been co-crucified with Messiah and no longer lives. What if that were true? What if that were really true? What if you actually believed the Bible? How different would you be if this was not a concept of theology, but was an actual practical reality?
Come on.
Let's keep going. For the nails of his cross crucified me with him. And now the essence of this new life is no longer mine, for the anointed one lives his life through me.
Amen.
We live in union. My new life is empowered by the faith in the Son of God.
No.
No, that's not what it says. By the faith of the Son of God. Big difference there. Who loves me so much that he gave himself for me and dispenses his life into mine. If you have a pulse, just if you're not sure, just reach up and just right about here. Are you breathing? If you're a believer in Christ Jesus, guess what? You're Satan's biggest nightmare. If you, sister, if you ever discover what's inside of you, he's going to backpedal and backpedal and back. The reason why Satan takes footholds in families is because they don't know who they are.
Come on.
Well, addiction runs in my household. Yeah, my mom, she was a drunk. Her mom was a drunk.
Or daddy bet, mama bet, we all bet. We all crazy. You know, stupid runs in our family, just generations back. Well, that might have been true until the day that Christ saved you. But at that moment, if the scripture is correct, he severed your past. He got a hatchet out and said, no! No, no, no. That generational bondage that has plagued you to your 27th year, that stuff is over. You will not die depressed. You will not die addicted. And my question to you today is this. If this is truth, why do we live so far beneath our privileges?
Yeah, right.
Today, to be a Christian, it's almost a secret society.
That's right.
Are you a believer? Shh, workers over there. I don't
don't want them to talk to the boss and tell them that I go to church or anything, because it might hurt my professional career.
Come on, man.
Are you serious? Hey, listen, that do you think that Superman hides the S on his chest? Come on. Under the right conditions, mild-mannered Clark Kent disrobes and he's changed from this presentable, meek personality to something ferocious and powerful. Well, when Christ saved you, did he not intend for what limited you and what bound you? Did he not intend for the grave clothes of your old identity to fall off you and for you to look down your chin? What in the world? Pastor Mike, there's an S there. Saved, hallelujah, sanctified. That's what it means. And when you realize that Christ is in you, you don't walk like you used to walk. And you don't think like you used to think. And you don't talk like you used to talk. My cursing problem stopped on October 28, 1984. Because at that moment, everything I thought, my vocabulary, everything that made my mind, at that moment, something fundamentally changed in my life on that Sunday night. Because when I woke up Monday morning, the curse wasn't in my vocabulary, because it wasn't in my heart. God vaccinated me and changed me. He said, I've got a new vocabulary for you. You don't know anything about it yet, so I'm going to take that old stuff out and put something new in. Something's wrong. When we go to church and just, oh God, it's Sunday morning.
Come on.
Oh, Kelly sings three. Too fast, one slow. I mean, CBS, NFL on CBS Come kicks on. Off. The pregame's at 10:30. I mean 10. And then the expert analysis is 11, and the kickoff's at 11:45. So, God, can we just get through it? Can we just have like a normal, one of those freeze dried denominations, services, like 45 minutes? Can we just get like a 45 minute service and go? No, we're not going to do that here. You know why? Because that's true.
Amen.
I'm not done yet. Keep going, please. Now, I want you to read this with me, because this is going to blow your tiny brain cells out of the water. Ready? Let's go. Christ's resurrection.
Your resurrection.
Keep going. Keep going. Wait. I guess y'all don't feast like mammals. I'm going to do it. Ready? Let's go. Ready? Yes. Feast on all the treasures of the heavenly realm and fill your thoughts with heavenly realities. And not with the distractions of the natural realm. It's in the Word, saint. Keep going, please. Two more verses. Your crucifixion with Christ. And now your true life is hidden away in God, in Christ. And as Christ himself is seen for who he really is, who you really are will also be revealed. For you are now one with him in his glory. Johnny, you're right. What happened to? I'll tell you what happened. Denominational politics got involved. It became more about how many we got rather than how many are on fire. It became about how many bodies we can count, how much who we're sending here, there. No. Listen, Jesus did not die for an organization. Jesus is the organism that you and I are united to. It's not about an organization. I mean, there's room and time and place for organizational methodologies, but when it comes to reality, the reality is that I am in Christ and Christ is in me.
Amen.
And if I could stand up here this morning, I could tell you a story, and my wife can come up here and tell you story after story after story of generational issues in her family and in my family. And she will tell you this, and my grandchildren that are here today will tell you this. They know some things about our past and about our family's past. And they will tell you that Papa and Nanny, or Papa and Nanny, don't live like that. You know why? Because this is real.
Yes, it is.
There's some people think like this. They think, well, you know, I wasn't born in a privileged situation. I didn't have what you have. I didn't have anything either. I came as a beggar. Nothing in my hand I bring. Simply to that cross I cling.
And if Jesus can look down from heaven and have mercy on a pitiful, pathetic human like me, there's nobody outside the realm of grace. Nobody outside the realm of grace. I said there's nobody outside the realm of grace. That's why you don't judge a single solitary soul. Because if they're breathing, they're a candidate. I said if they're breathing, they're a candidate. I told you a story years ago, and I'm going to end with this morning. This is how I know that grace is real. This is how I know God is real. Years ago when we were in Texas, when Chase was a little bitty, I met a man and got to know him pretty well. He was an avowed racist. He could not stand black people. Can we just talk this morning like, brothers, well, it's too late now, I didn't stuck it out. So. And in that part of Texas, there was a history. We didn't know that when we went there. We moved there because Jesus wanted us to go and love people and want to serve and be a part of his kingdom there. And I don't really know. I think it was in, where'd she go? There she is. Was it 2003 when Ricky and Trish came?
Yeah.
It was. Ricky and Trish Hall, two of the sweetest, purest souls that God ever created. And I grew up in the faith with them. And Ricky's skin color is black, and obviously mine's not quite as dark as his. It's just a different, lighter shade of brown. And his precious wife, Trish, Jesus, have mercy. If she was on this platform singing Amazing Grace, you'd belly crawl to the altar and snot your way to heaven. They came to this part of Texas. We picked them up at the airport on a Friday night, brought them to our place. And on that Sunday morning, see, when God gets a hold of your heart, he makes you colorblind. I mean, you could care less what nationality or derivation or genealogy or educational level or economic, none of those distinctions matter because you get Jesus' eyesight. And so Sunday morning came, and Ricky was, we did something Saturday night too, didn't we? I can't remember. I know we did three services. Anyway, and so there weren't that many people that the night time before Sunday. So Sunday morning comes, and Ricky was on the keyboard, and he sang a song that if I could sing worth 10 cents, I would sing today, because every time I hear the song, it was only around for a little while. It's called The Balm of Gilead. Close it down. And I'm going to tell you the truth. I mean, there's people in there that they, when the service started, they were just like this. I knew I was going to hear it from the board. And sure enough, about an hour after service, I got a phone call. You didn't tell us that couple that y'all brought. And it stopped, and I said, yes, continue. Well, you know, you didn't check with us and tell us that couple that you invited, you didn't tell us everything.
Come on. Come on, bring it out.
I said, okay, so what are you trying to say? Just don't worry about this. And I've heard it all. I've seen it all. I haven't done it all, but nothing you say is going to shock me, so just get it on. Come on, let's do it. And he said, I didn't know they were colored.
Come on.
This guy worked for years outside in the oil fields. And I said, I won't call his name. I said, are you wearing short sleeves? It was November. No. I'm going to take care of my cabin in a minute. Why? And I said, roll up your sleeve there if you can. Just unbutton it there and just roll up your sleeve a little bit. This is open phone. And so I said, I'm waiting. Hold on. Puts it down. Picks it back up. He says, I'm going to roll my sleeve up. What about it? And I said, now I've seen you at church side by side with me and side by side with my bride. I said, I want you to know something. You're twice as dark a shade of brown as I am. And I said, but I have never once complained to the board about you. And he shut up. He didn't say another word. He didn't say another word at the next group meeting. I never said another word about it. But about 3 months later, he said this. He because he wanted a part of business that somebody he wanted to say that we want to add to the bylaws. You know, that's always a problem when those come in. We want to add to the bylaws that any invitation to a visiting speaker must be submitted to the board within 30 days or out, 30 days out of their visit, potential visit, and all that. So I'm reading this stuff and I'm thinking, are you serious? Well, thank God there was a godly man on the board. He said this, he said, that's hogwash. I'll not vote for that. Another guy was there and he said this, he said, I was in the military. I careered in the military. He said, my best friends were not white.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
One was Greek.
Come on.
His last name, I could not ever pronounce. He said, he was my best friend. He was he had my back. Every time we ever did anything,
yes,
anything important, he was there for me.
Yes.
There was a Spanish guy in our platoon. It was a Eurasian in our platoon. He said, I thought the cross was where all distinctions and differences, male and female. I'm sitting down when he starts talking. I thought the cross was where all the distinctions that divided us and, you know, where racism and hatred and bigotry and all, I thought the cross was where all that stuff died. And what came out of the ground after those distinctions died was one new man. And that was all I could take. I had to say, woo, glory to God. Somebody's listening, praise you, Jesus, hallelujah. Because if you are in Christ,
yes,
and if Christ is in you, the only thing that matters is what's under the skin, sister. What matters is what's under the skin, brother. It's not your color. It's the blood of Jesus on the inside that makes you and me, brother and sister. Come on, give it praise to somebody. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Jesus, thank you. He breaks every barrier, praise God. He erased everything that divided us. And I believe the Bible. I believe that if you and I could see ourselves as Christ does today,
amen,
that denominational politics would end once and for all. That racism, you know, it was said years ago that the greatest divide in our culture was 11 o'clock on a Sunday morning. Because there are white churches and non-white churches. And I praise God, when I came here years ago, somebody asked something about my past, and I said, I don't have a past. I have a future. I'm for anybody who walks in that door. I don't care how tall they are, how short they are, how wide they are, how narrow they are, how dark they are, or how not. What I care about is, do you know Jesus? Let me introduce him to you. Because if you don't know him, I want you to know him. You've got to know him.
Come on.
And when Christ comes inside, not only do you forget all about color, but you forget all about limitations in your own past. You forget about what daddy did for forever and ever. What his dad did, you forget all those things because it's erased. Remember, that line's been severed.
Yes.
Just nudge your neighbor. I want you to go ahead, just nudge your neighbor. Be real sweet. Don't hurt him. Just nudge your neighbor and tell them, you are a new man. I know what you're thinking. That's a woman. Galatians says this, sisters, listen to me. Galatians says this. For you are all sons of God through Jesus Christ. Do you know why it says that? That's another distinction that was obliterated at the cross. Because in Hebrew culture and Jewish tradition, the males had priority and the females did not. And God said, no, that limitation is obliterated too. When Jesus died, he broke that chain, that bondage too. And guess what? You have equal rights as a sister in Christ. I don't know about you, but I'm more in love with Jesus now than I've ever been in my whole life. Will you stand with me this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Appreciate you. I appreciate you. Anybody around you that you don't know? If there is, just reach over and tell them welcome to the family. Thank you, Jesus. Will you pray with me this morning? Father, we thank you for what Jesus has done for us. We thank you that Jesus has severed the ties to our past. We have a new name in glory. Hallelujah. We have a new nature in Christ Jesus. The bondages of our past are obliterated. And because of Jesus, my life is expanding. Hallelujah. My love is unlimited. God, my passion is not bound by somebody's ethnicity or anything else about them. God, you vaccinated me against racism, against bigotry, against class distinction. You've made us see every person as valuable in Jesus Christ. And God, I want every person in Marshall County, Alabama to know you. God, I want them to be involved in a church and with a body, with a fellowship that honors and values them just the way they are. God, you didn't call us to Sand Mountain to fix people. You didn't call us to Sand Mountain to straighten people out. You called us to Sand Mountain to love people right where they live, just like they are, and to celebrate your grace and to watch you work. God, that's what you've done today as we have done the baptismal service. So many of those precious people, God, they've come so far from where they started. They didn't come because of threats. They didn't come because of forced catechism classes. They came because grace invited them forward. They came because Jesus is real. His cross is real. His resurrection is real. Hallelujah. And his resurrection is shared with those who find their identity in him. Thank you, Jesus. I know you did this once before, but reach over and take the hand one more time. Come on, Josh. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. This is a great, big, beautiful body. Father, today we celebrate your grace. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for sending heaven's very best to rescue us from our past and to stop it in its tracks. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for giving us a love for every person, regardless of their age, their intelligence, their financial situation, or their religious tradition. None of that matters in Christ. Your word declares that we are new creations. And Father, because of that, we're going to experience joy unspeakable and full of glory. We're going to celebrate people's experience with you. They may stumble and fall, but not so we can judge them or analyze or criticize, but so that we can be there to help them up and say, he's worth the trip. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. Don't stop. Don't stop. Let me help you. Let me walk with you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, this week, on the job or at school, at the ball field, wherever we may find ourselves, Father, help us to be a true representation of Jesus. Our love is so pure, so powerful, and so real. We do not notice things that divide. God, vaccinate our hearts. Give us eyes to see like Jesus sees. God, most of all, give us hearts that love like Jesus loves. Thank you, Jesus. We love you. Now let that hand go and stretch it up with me high as you can. Jesus, I praise you. I bless you. I honor you. I thank you for your faithfulness. I praise you, Father. I praise you, Lord, for what you've invested in us. I thank you, Lord, that there is nothing we've ever done that disqualifies us from growing up into our identity in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you're patient with us when we need it. Thank you that you're faithful to us. Even when we are faithless, you are still faithful. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. This week, help us to demonstrate and share the love that you placed in our hearts with all those that are around us. God, others may see and know that Jesus truly is more beautiful than anything else in comparison. We love you. We exalt you. We bless you. Thank you, Lord. In your name we pray and agree. And all God's children shouted amen.
Amen.
Shouted amen.
Amen.
Come on, give them a hand clap of praise this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. We love the Lord. We love the Lord. We love the Lord. Now, other 44 you didn't hug this morning on your way in, make sure you hug them on your way out. Would you do it? We'll see you Tuesday night at Men's Ministry.